So in this talk, I'm going to just touch upon some of the work we have done in the oxide-based thermoelectric material and a flexible device for energy harvesting. So first, the big question is why thermoelectrics, right? If you're looking at this figure, has been showing the estimated U.S. energy use. If you're looking at on the left, right, so this is a form of the energy production, and on the right is the energy output. So regardless what type of energy production, either from solar or natural gas or from petroleum, and what happens is you have 60%, almost 60% of the energy is wasted as the heat, as some form of the heat is rejected here. So it's the big question, is this possible we can reharvesting this rejected heat and converting to electricity? Of course, we all know answer is yes, right? There is a lot of ways to reharvesting this energy. And one particular way we're looking at our research group is the thermoelectricity. And we all know this scientific effect of the thermoelectricity was discovered by Thomas Seebeck in the 1884. And what happens is if you put a semiconductor material or two distillate metal on the hot and the cold junction, what happens is the temperature difference will drive the electron moving from hot to cold side. That will generate an open circuit voltage, right? That is what we all know, the Seebeck effect. And by harvesting the Seebeck effect, we can generate a thermoelectric material. The quality of the thermoelectric material is measured by this particular unitless figure. It's called a ZT, figure of merit. Figure of merit has three parameters. Intrinsic material property is determined by your Seebeck coefficient, determined by your electrical conductivity, and the thermoconductivity, of course, which has a contribution from electron part and the phonon lattice vibration. The total efficiency of the thermoelectric device as a heat engine is determined by the quality of the material, and the device, of course, is also ultimately determined by Carnot efficiency, right? Delta T over the T hot. As such, the temperature of the device can be used in this delta T, and the hot junction will be very important. Not only in the ZT, but this is also important parameter, which is something we have been focused in our work. We all know it's very challenging to get a high efficiency thermoelectric. This work has been going, you know, over the decades, and it's still we have a ZT roughly about 1 or 1.5. Why? Because the reason, as if you're looking at it, there are three parameters, right? Your Seebeck, your thermoconductivity, electroconductivity. However, the three parameters are interdependent. For instance, if I increase my carrier concentration, has been showing here, the Seebeck will reach to optimized value around the carrier concentration at 10^19, and it will degenerate. Because of your drastically reduced band gap at the higher doping concentration. However, that will increase your electrical conductivity, which is really in favor of getting high thermoelectric. Unfortunately, that will also increase your thermoconductivity, K value here, due to drastically increased thermoconductivity from electron contribution. So as such, it's very difficult to get to the very optimized ZT value. One of the work has been going in the community is how can we using the nanostructure to decouple the electron and phonon transport. So therefore we can drastically still increase the electroconductivity. However, not to deteriorate our thermoconductivity, right? By reduce your phonon thermoconductivity. So that's what another thing we'll talk about it in this talk. So in contrast, the most commonly thermoelectric work going on in the community, we have been looking at the nitrides and oxides work, and particular oxides. And why is that? If you're looking at this figure on the left, it's really showing what has happened in the community in the last few decades. As we can see, there are a lot of active research group working in the lower temperature regime from 200 to 400 Kelvin, we actually has been numerously reported a very high temperature of a very high ZT value by using telluride-based material, which is great. However, the telluride is toxicity, right? And a very expensive material. So if you want to use a commercialization, there's a big challenge. On the higher temperature side, the silicon germanium has definitely shown great promise. Again, the same thing with the cost of the germanium and the materials, the wide application of the material has some challenges. On the other hand, you know, on the oxide material has been very cost effective and non-toxic. And we do see some report to the work on the using the gallium and aluminum co-doped zinc oxide has reached some very nice N-type of the thermoelectric values. And another thing I would like to point it out, as you can see, the ZT value has continuously increased rather than like silicon germanium or other material. This ZT value will decrease over the temperature. And the reason because of the bipolar conduction as a narrow band gap, when you get into the higher temperature, your intrinsic doping will jump into your conduction band that cancel your external doping characteristic, which is not has been observed in the oxide as the wide band gap material. So with that, we has looking at oxide compared with you know, conventional thermoelectric material. If you're looking at, there is a lot of advantage, right? A low environmental cost, low environmental impact, non-toxic material, and also as showing here is very clear, oxide and nitride has very high thermal stability that can up to the 1200 C, which is most of the industrial process of wasted heat actually has been concentrated in this area. So some of the previous work, which I would like to show here is if you're looking at, you know, in the early 2000s, there is a tremendous work has been really looking at cobalt oxides. And we have been finding, you know, sodium doped cobalt oxide actually and can be a very good P-type material. And on the N-type side, as you see, the gallium aluminum doped, co-doped zinc oxide has been good N-type of material. So in our work, we have been looking at the different approach, a very fundamental material science approach, looking at a material quality and your figure of merit by, in order to observe that, we have been synthesizing material by using these methods called the metal organic chemical vapor deposition. Some of you must be very familiar with. So basically you have grown in the material from atomic layer using the vapor deposition and through the gas chamber using this equipment at a Burke Nanotechnology Center at Purdue University. And the growth schematic, it looks like this. Dimethyl zinc has been used as our precursor and the nitrogen is used as a carrier gas. So at the 5 Celsius and we evaporate off this dimethyl zinc. And then we use a carrier gas as nitrogen as a carrier gas and they come into the growth chamber and pick it up your dimethyl zinc. And then an oxygen as a reacting precursor. And we keep the temperature at 500 C and the 30 torr. So this is basically a low pressure reaction. So we can control the growth speed and we can control the film quality. And from there we get the nice zinc oxide thin film. So here I want to show you the results, some of the experimental results as we have been showing growth mechanism. So how the quality of the film looking at, if you're looking at here, we can see the carrier density versus the electroconductivity. We can see conductivity drastically increased after the 10th of 19th carrier concentration. This is primarily attributed to intrinsic N-type of the doping by point defects. such as oxygen vacancy, zinc interstitial, and zinc antiside defects that drastically increase your unintentionally doping carrier concentration, and that increase the conductivity. And we're also looking at the mobility versus the carrier concentration. And then we can see by measuring different mobility mechanism, if you're looking at this purple line, which is the polar optical phonon interaction and versus a piezoelectric scattering mechanism. And then we're looking at how the mobility affects with the carrier density. The red color is theoretical mobility limits at the carrier concentration about the 10^20. As we can see, our experimental data, it's getting quite close with the theoretical limits. Although there is still some disparities. However, one thing I would like to point it out is the theoretical prediction, as we have been showing, the mobility is reduced with the increase of carrier density, which is somewhat expected because you have a lot of the defect scattering center, which will really scatter your electron mobility, reduce the velocity. But in this case, our experimental results see the opposite trend. We see the carrier density increase with the carrier concentration with the mobility. We think that's because of electron and the plasmon interaction, which has been showing in some of the polar optophonon scattering. This is the dominant scattering mechanism in this particular case. And then we're looking at the seebeck coefficient and carrier density versus film quality. In this case, we have been grown a couple of different films, and we have been grown zinc oxide and gallium nitride. And we're looking at the carrier density versus the seebeck coefficient. Clearly, you see the drastic reduce of the seebeck coefficient versus carrier density, which again, it's because of your increased defect center, and that it really increased your electrical electron scattering, and then that reduce your average velocity of the electron over your energy level. And so as such, we have been observed also by using this PL photoluminescence results. As you can see, this is inset is the deep level emission. And clearly we can see full wave half maximum will be increased with the reduced of the seebeck coefficient, right? So your film quality is actually closely related with your seebeck coefficient. Degenerated film will reduce the seebeck coefficient because of the increased scattering of the carriers. This has been further validated by using the X-ray diffraction characterization, has been showing on the right hand of the figure, has been showing here. As you can see, the omega to omega scan has been showing very clearly when the dislocation density, so we keep dislocation density as 10^10, and we have been looking at the seebeck coefficient from 20 microvolts per Kelvin to 110 microvolts per Kelvin, we can see actually drastically reduced full width half maximum, and then increase the film quality of the zinc oxide. Of course, as we can expect, the power factor has been drastically increased with your carrier density. This is a very good news because in a sense, we are increased our carrier density, we can have a higher power output. So one thing I would like to emphasize in this talk is most community has been focused on ZT, which is very important. That is to showing the quality of the material. However, on the other hand, I think a power output is another very important parameters if we're looking at the material for power generation application. So we're also looking at the maximum value of the power factor versus the film quality. As you can see in here, we're looking at the seebeck coefficient versus logarithm of the electroconductivity. We see actually very interesting effect is the seebeck coefficient. It's in linearship with the natural algorithm of your CVAC, your electrical conductivity. So what happens is really is to showing this is a CVAC coefficient is closely linearly related to the electrical conductivity and the mobility. Further conclusion can looking further observation about the CVAC coefficient versus the film quality of the zinc oxide has been really validated by comparing bulk zinc oxide and thin film zinc oxide. As you know, the bulk zinc oxide is typically has a lighter, lower dislocation density, and although they have a lower carrier density, and then with the thin film zinc oxide, we have a higher carrier density, as we can see, a drastically reduced CVAC coefficient. So again, this is a very closely related to the material quality. And one thing we're very excited is actually we can reach the very high CVAC coefficient, which is about the 770 microvolts per Kelvin by using the oxide-based material. And we also can see the predominant the scattering mechanism in this case is actually impurity scattering, which very close to our experimental data. So this is a further validated by this PEL results. As you can see, you know, the film quality has been increased when you shifted from the thin film to the bulk, and then we can see the drastically reduce the full wave half maximum of this band gap emission. So when you're looking at the power factor versus the carrier density, we can see the power factor drastically increased with the carrier density, and really the optimized the carrier density in our case is about 10^17 to the 18th and the full oxides material. So that's a part of the pure zinc oxide. And then we're looking at, you know, how can we drastically increase the zinc oxide and further reduce the thermal conductivity? As we know, oxide material as the thermoelectric, the biggest challenge is intrinsically high thermal conductivity, which is less desire for the material. So in this particular work, and we're looking at how can we reduce the thermal conductivity without deteriorating electrical property. So the gross mechanism of this work is we're using the bulk zinc oxide and as your substrate. And then on top of that, we grow gallium nitride as an epi layer and the indium gallium nitride material. So we're making this nice composites material as being shown here. One thing I would like to point it out is as you can see this high resolution TEM image, right? And as you can see within this green boundary, there is this very less dislocation and really very less defects. If you compare the typical gallium nitride or zinc oxide grown on sci-fire substrate, this is really because of a lattice match between the gallium nitride and the zinc oxide. They're typically less than 2%. So therefore we can get a very high, nice quality of the film. And we do not see the any second phase separation. As you can see, we have very nice zinc oxide sharp peak as a substrate here. And then we see a very nice secondary peak about the indium gallium nitride, indium here. However, reach over 32%, and then we start to see phase separation of the material. Material quality has started degenerating. So mobility and the conductivity of the material looking at versus the carrier concentration. Again, in this case, we observe their carrier density increase, your mobility decrease, which is somewhat expected because again, increase the carrier density, increase your defect center, increase their scattering rate. However, we see the larger carrier actually has been contributed quite a bit on the conductivity. So in other words, the larger amount of the carrier really compensated the reduction of the mobility. So the carrier conductivity actually increased rapidly starting off the 10th and 20th. So we see the Seebeck versus power factor versus carrier density, and then we can see Seebeck coefficient drastically reduced and with the carrier density. And then the lowest Seebeck coefficient is 280 microvolts per Kelvin. And highest power value is about 680 × 10⁻⁴ watts per meter per Kelvin square. This is something I'm really excited and I want to report and maybe, you know, take a minute and go through in a very detail is we here to see a drastic reduced thermal conductivity. As I mentioned earlier, thermal conductivity of the oxide material has been really intrinsically challenging to making the oxides as a high quality of the thermoelectric material. As we all know, because the wide bandgap material and then also the heavy metal, and this thermal conductivity is typically about 150 or 100 watts per meter square. However, by using this layered nanostructure, we tuned the film thickness, we can drastically reduce the thermal conductivity to two order of magnitude as being shown here. We think the thermal conductivity actually is only 3.5 watts per meter per square. Kelvin in here, as you can see, so as a result, ZT value reached to 0.86 at room temperature at the doping level of the 10^20. And I would like to point it out, this about 6 times higher than that of silicon germanium, which is the state of art has been shown here, which is really the state of art of the thermoelectric material at the higher temperature application, as I've been showing in the introduction slides. And we also think an order of magnitude higher than the previous reported, such as the other works as has been showing here, even previously from our own research work. This is due to the drastically reduced the thermal conductivity and increase the electroconductivity through the nanostructuring. To summarize the thermoelectric of the ingot on zinc oxide substrate, and then we can see we actually reached the quite high Seebeck coefficient at the very high carrier concentration and at the high power factor. And this is really achieved by gallium nitride and zinc oxide co-doping regime, because in this case, it's not only your gallium nitride is doped by indium, but also the oxygen in the zinc oxide film can be migrated into the gallium nitride, which can dope gallium nitride into the conductive. On the same page, you know, the nitrogen atoms can migrate into the zinc oxide and then make it conductive. So we may see some parallel conduction there. That's actually reason to lead into the very high electroconductivity and the mobility here. So another thing we have done is to did some theoretical calculation by using the DFT and then also looking at the different B factors of the material by looking at the different deformation potential scattering mechanism. On the left, as you can see, if we're looking at acoustic deformation potential scattering, on the right is ionized impurity scattering. Regardless what type of the scattering, the red color circle is our experimental data, blue color is the optimized theoretical data. As you can see, we're actually getting very close to a theoretical value. And again, this is due to very high quality of the film and the controlled, very nicely controlled nanoscale. And this is a further concluded or observed by the X-ray diffraction and then your photoluminescence, looking at the band edge emission. Both has been showing well separated peaks from zinc oxide and gallium and indium gallium nitride layers. As we have been seeing, lower than 30% of the indium, we see a very distinct separation. However, you go into the higher concentration and then we do see the degenerated of the peak quality, which actually represents the degenerated film quality as well, which is observed from both X-ray and photoluminescence results. So we have not been stopped in the material level, right? So the next step is like, you know, we get a really good quality of the material. Is can we possibly to fabricate it into the thermoelectric devices? And what would be the power output? And not only that, we were looking at really it's a flexible thermoelectric devices. And I will talk about it in a second, why this, you know, form factor is very important. So if you're looking at the conventional thermoelectric device fabrication process is really discrete each steps, right? So it's a separate steps and each of them are very labor intensive. First, you have this commercial ingots and you ball milling into the nanostructure and then you use nano box synthesize and then you're dicing, you're polishing, you're making the p-n junction. And then you evaporate in contact on ceramic insulator materials. And then you kind of the sintering them together by using compression methods. So again, this each steps is separated and each step is very labor intensive and time consuming. As a result, total cost of the device has been reported by Professor Shannon Ye at Georgia Tech in this nice paper in back in the 2013, as you can see, materials only cost less than one third. A lot of the cost is actually really coming from this very cumbersome processing methods. So that's number one. Number two, as a result, this device actually is rigid, has very flat surface. Unfortunately, in the industry application, if you're looking at the most industrial wasted heat at the high temperature is curvature. So therefore there's a lot of wasted heat will be, a lot of heat will be wasted and cannot be reharvested because of this curvature. So the question is if it's possible, we can make it a flexible curvature that has better contact with your the heat surface, right? So therefore you can create a better thermal pass, which is another thing we have been really focused in our study. So of course, to design the thermoelectric generator, there's a couple of things you need to looking at. It's not only about material quality, but also from device level. And you're really looking at it, this is what we call the electro and thermal resistance network model. And then we need to balance your resistivity from the electrical and the thermal side. And then by using this model actually developed by my collaborator and Greek colleagues and Professor Yazawa at Burke Nanotechnology Center at Purdue University, we have developed we have been using this model and developed our thermoelectric devices, really looking at the heat and electrical network model to balance the resistivity in the device. So by using this model, we have been find out the optimized the thickness of our thermoelectric device is a 5 nanometer and that act of 5 millimeter, I'm sorry, that can keep both your maximum power output as being shown here, but also can keep you flexibility because otherwise it will become very hard to bend. The mechanical force will actually break your device. And we also looking at the your fuel factors, right? So we have been showing the maximum power output with idea module design has been can show the potential up to the 48 watts per meter square range. Of course, this is, you need to a larger fuel factor, right? Again, thermoelectric is generated DC power. So you can think each PN junction or PN set as a battery, right? Of course, more you pack into this device, a bigger power output that you can expecting if you can optimize the resistivity, right? Internal and external resistivity has been showing here. So the device generation at our lab, we completely using a new processing method is developed at the lab and also patented. And then in this case, what we did is we actually print all the contacts in the capton substrate. And by using inkjet printing with the design pattern, and then we film And then this is another printing process. And to fill all the P and N type of material has been showing into this blue and red color. And then we use the PDMS and to fill it and then packaging it. This is have a several beauty, and it's actually provided a better packaging, and also because of the intrinsic lower electrical and thermal conductivity of the PDMS, and actually created a better thermal pass. As being shown here, this is the completed conformal or flexible thermoelectric TEG devices. As you can see, it can definitely be flexible and attached, have this nice curvature and attached on the pipeline for energy harvesting, which is our intent in the usage. And again, the power output is really depends on how many PN junction you pack it into this device. So what is the device performance, right? So we actually had did some nice testing, our TEG device setup. As you can see here, this is a testing setup. And what happens is we keep the cold side, right? So this is the two different tubes, and then we have hot water and cold water inside. And then we keep the cold side fixed at 5C, and the hot side increase from 5C to 55C. So we can see the TEG module with a nice thermal interface, right? As you can see here, we have done a very nice modeling for the thermoelectric thermal profile. And we can see we got the heat transfer coefficient is about 240 watts per square meter and per Kelvin. So I'm getting really close to the finishing, as here we can show the load resistance is really matching with the internal resistance of the TEG module, and the measured data and the fitting data has perfectly aligned. The final results. So what is our power output, right? So here the power output density is 1.26 milliwatts per square centimeter or per square meter with a delta T is 50 Celsius. However, we only use the full pair of the TE legs. As you can imagine, if we pack this up, this number will be definitely increased. So with that, I'm going to summarize the talk. And in this talk, and you know, we're very excited to report, we have done this work by using the indium gallium nitride grown on zinc oxide substrate, and we have enriched the ZT equal to 0.86 at room temperature. And this is about 6 times higher than silicon germanium. Again, this is the state of art of the thermoelectric material, and we also reached the order of magnitude higher than the previous reported on any oxides and nitrides material. And not only that, by using the similar material, we actually developed a prototype of flexible thermoelectric devices that can have a power density and that is applicable for the industrial application, and that can be further used to making the self-powered IoT devices and the sensoring application. So with that, I would like to wrap up my talk, and I would like to take this moment to really acknowledge the postdoc scientists at my research lab and the grad students who had contributed to this work, and really also acknowledging National Science Foundation and particular two programs and from a career and the IIP and prototyping of the thermoelectric devices, and without their contribution and generous support, and this work cannot come into the realization. And also thanks for this opportunity to share my work and for your